Hi, I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer. Court documents that were recently obtained show that the Mormon Church has been covering up disgusting acts of sexual abuse for years. We're going to tell you the story behind that story. The fallout from Nancy Pelosi's trip to Taiwan, well, it's adding up, and the United States may have permanently endangered our relationship with China on many issues. We'll bring you the details. And the FBI has raided Donald Trump's golf course, South Florida mansion. We'll tell you what that means for the former president. All that and more, it's all coming up. Don't go anywhere. America's Lawyer starts right now. Unsealed court documents reveal a massive sex abuse cover-up inside the Mormon Church. Ring of Fire's Farron Cousins joins me to talk about that and many other issues. 6 years of sex abuse for a five-year-old. The Mormon Church was told this is going on. And what do they do with that material?
Nothing. They did absolutely nothing with it. And this is just one of many instances now that we're finding out. But this particular story is so disturbing because not only was the father molesting his five-year-old daughter, eventually his wife got pregnant again. And then when the baby turned 6 weeks old, he began sexually assaulting that baby as well.
Yeah, all this story is, it's just a way in to talk to you and everybody about how dysfunctional. Now, I call them a cult. People can get mad at me. It's a cult. I mean, if you really look behind this, the fact that these folks even got a tax write-off to be a church is as ridiculous as the Scientologist getting a write-off like that. But it's the Church of Latter-day Saints. You had a man who was being treated as a pornography addict, goes to the bishop, says, "Mr. Bishop, I have been molesting my five-year-old child," spills the beans. The bishop then goes to the lawyers, the national lawyers, not the local lawyers, but the lawyers who are calling all the shots. And the lawyer says, "Whatever you do, don't tell the police. Whatever you do, don't report this to child welfare where they can go in there and save that baby." That is the most disgusting. And you know what? When this case develops, they need to sue that lawyer right along with the church. He's part of it. And from the other side, the church needs to sue that lawyer for malpractice, because this is blowing up like crazy right now.
It is. And what the church did was they had set up a tip line for their, you know, clergy members or even their regular members to report sexual abuse. So, I mean, they knew the problem was bad enough that what they did was they set up this tip line. They said, "Hey, if you hear anything, you call the tip line. You don't call the police, like you said. You don't call authorities or DCF. Call this tip line for us here. We'll handle it. Don't worry about it.
You know, you and I have done this story before about what the tip line is all about. The tip line is keeping it quiet. It's like what you see universities doing right now.
Yeah.
Colleges, universities all over this country, when a woman is raped, they take them first to a committee. And that person then has to sign off to where I'm going to live with what the committee decides. It's worse than arbitration, because here you have the university that's running the program. That's the same thing that's happening here. And, you know, first of all, there is no clergy. There's no clergy privilege in Arizona. There's about 20 states in the union that same thing. There's no clergy privilege. So, first of all, the lawyer committed malpractice. They need to be sued. And they certainly need to be brought into this lawsuit as a necessary party.
Right. And another thing about the tip line that was really shocking in this massive report that's come out was that they revealed that at the end of every single workday, the tip line workers were instructed, take all the records you took from that day, destroy them. Mm-hmm. You do not keep anything. So basically, at the end of the day, every day, it's a clean slate. There's no record of who you talked to. There's no record of what was reported to you. There is nothing. And unfortunately, this leads the people who call the tip line to think, okay, I did what I'm supposed to do. They're going to handle it. This guy's going to go to jail for a long time. I'm good to go.
If this was just one story, we'd be reporting it. But this is bigger than one story.
Yeah.
They turned off 12,000 pages in a West Virginia lawsuit that is OMG kind of material, because it shows you that the infrastructure of the Mormon Church not only covered it up, but what they would do is they'd make it disappear. Not, I mean, like you're talking, they destroy documents. And the tip line is simply the way, it's a hook. Get this person into the church handling the problem, and we're going to make it go away. This story has just started. Matter of fact, you know we handle these kinds of abuse cases. We're getting calls from all over the country, primarily Mormons, that are saying, hey, this happened to me too. This is the beginning. And I promise you, I'll bring in any law firm that's given that church the advice not to report this. I'll bring them in as a necessary party, part of a RICO if I have to. Saudi Arabia is setting a new record this year by beheading more victims, more criminals. Okay, the thing that struck me about this is here, how many billion dollars did Biden just say we're going to send to the Saudis? How many billion was it? 23 billion.
23 billion. Yeah.
23 billion. We're going to give them $23 billion in aggressive weapons, not defense weapons, but in aggressive weapons that are things like, the F-35. It's the top of our technology. High-tech drones that are used for aggression, not support, not defense. Excuse me.
Well, yeah, and you know, this is, again, one of the biggest human rights abusers on the planet, and we've known this for decades. Every administration, you know, for the last, well, pretty much my entire life, has said, we're okay with your human rights abuses. You have that thing we love so much, oil. So we're not going to call you out for any of this. And we have 120 people that have lost their heads in Saudi Arabia so far this year in just the first 6 months. And it's for things like participating in pro-democracy demonstrations.
41 people beheaded for participating in democratic types of protests. 37 for nonviolent events, to where the government won't even release what they beheaded that person for. These are the same people that Biden called ruthless pariah. It's this psycho, self-appointed, unstable prince that's in charge of everything. And this is what we're agreeing. Yeah, this is a good idea. Let's give them $23 billion in weapons. Now, you talked about oil. You've done some great stories where you said it's not really just about oil. It's also about the weapons industry. That's where the big money is here. When we send $23 billion to say, look, we're going to send you all the people who make the money on that is people like Raytheon.
Yeah.
You know, they love this. They don't mind that this guy's a ruthless, psychopathic killer, do they?
No, absolutely not. In fact, that works a little bit in their favor because they know, okay, this guy's unstable. He's going to go attack everybody he can out there. The more missiles he uses, the more he has to come back and beg us to buy from us.
Yeah.
So we continue to make money. So we'll look the other way when you line up 30 people who were protesting because they want actual rights in their country. Yeah, you cut their heads off with a sword. That's what they call put before the sword.
But how do you go from saying these are ruthless pariah to say, okay, ruthless pariah, we know you're psychopaths. We know Israel is right next door. We see what you're doing in Yemen. You are just leveling Yemen. But we're going to give you more, not defensive weapons. These are aggressive attack kinds of weapons. This is a story. You see it in corporate media?
No.
Of course not, because MSNBC, CNN, you look at their shows at night, they're advertising Raytheon. Like, you know, let's go buy a missile. You tell me. All that is they're buying access to MSNBC's talking heads. That's why they put all those war pimps on there, people who would go to war with the entire damn world if we let them.
Well, and we actually found this story in the British media. I think it's important to point out to people.
Interesting. So. You found the story. Good find. A powerful energy company in Florida has been running a secret lounge used to lobby politicians. Wow. Okay. Let me lay it out a little bit. It's 3,000 square feet. It's hidden from the public. There's no way that you even know that the Florida Power and Light or Next Era, who owns Power and Light, owns this. And it's been described by the politicians who go there and the lobbyists who go there is the nicest venue in Tallahassee that some people call Tallanasty, because there's not a lot of venues like they've built here.
Well, and it is, you know, the media did describe this very aptly as this is as close to the smoke-filled back rooms that, you know, we've heard legends about as you're ever going to get, because that is exactly what this is. They bring in lobbyists, they bring in the politicians from right down the street at the Capitol.
Regulators.
Yeah, they bring in the regulators and they say, hey, come on in, have a couple drinks on me, look at this nice plush place. You have to have a special employee who has a key card access to even get in. There's no signage on the outside of the building, so nobody even knows what this place is. But it's so they can basically rub elbows and tell people, listen, you got to give us this legislation. We'll put money in your campaign. We'll schmooze you. We'll wine and dine you. Everybody goes home happy.
And what does it accomplish? It accomplishes in Florida right now. You have people that are paying rates. You have we get calls all the time. Unfortunately, we can't sue them. They have this weird immunity that doesn't allow us to sue them. Mother of two called a couple of weeks ago. Mike, I can't pay my bill and feed my children. Retirees who are living on a fixed pension that have gone, their bill has gone from $100 to $400 a month. And the regulators, who, by the way, hang out at this really ritzy venue where they're served free liquor, those regulators are the people who said, yeah, you can go ahead and raise your rates $10 billion. It doesn't make any difference to us. Doesn't make any difference how you load it. You can front end it, load it, however you want to do it. And it's just absolute pay to play. That's what this is.
It really is. And just so people understand, too, you know, my power bill was about $200. It jumped up, the one I just paid yesterday, $540 month.
It's not just Florida. You see, this is next era. Next era is, honest to God, they have been caught with their hands in the till so many times where they're clear influencing politicians. In Florida, the question is, are they violating our sunshine laws? Are they violating a law that says you can't simply gift things like liquor and a venue like this to politicians, and you have to report when you're going to meet with our politicians. That's what this is. It's a closed door meeting. And you know what? Taxpayers and consumers are paying for that.
Well, and what's even more interesting too is that even inside this secret floor of this building where the room exists, there's also a second secret room.
Yeah, talk about
that. So there's another secret room, and that is where the real, you know, backroom deals are taking place. Yeah. Again, you got to have a different key card to get into that one. And this is, I mean, my God, if you were to put this in a movie, people would say, well, that's just too unrealistic. Yeah. That's way too on the nose. You're exaggerating. Yeah. But it's happening probably right this second in Tallahassee, Florida.
Okay, well, what we know from looking at documents, and again, people don't understand, I can't sue them. I get calls all the time. Can you sue them? No, I can't because of the way the laws are written. But here's what we do know from the documents we found. There's a clear effort to influence state electors. They want to set up news sites to go after critics. They're doing that right now. They're actually, they were caught having a private investigator follow a reporter who was critical of them. Followed them around for months, took pictures, were just right in their front yard following these reporters. They want to go about buying media outlets. They're doing it right here in North Florida. As you know, we started a campaign against them talking about what bums they were and how they were stealing from Florida consumers. And then what happens? Florida Power and Light comes in, spends a ton of money in the media to say, oh, we're gonna make you a lot of money if you'll just stick with us.
Yeah, and it's the buying up, of those media outlets that again is so worrisome here, because obviously when you have corporations that come in and buy media outlets, all you get is favorable coverage. So what they're doing is they're running a massive propaganda campaign to say, look at us, we've done nothing wrong. We're the good guys in this. Mm. They go to their little smoke-filled back rooms, they cut the deals with politicians, get everything they've ever wanted. I mean, this is mafia-like behavior that we're seeing.
We're seeing the stories firsthand. Like, you can afford that $500. But what if you are a single mother raising two kids,
right. And
you have to decide, can I buy food for my children? Can I put clothes on their back for school? Or do I pay this bill? And you know what? There is no compromise with these folks. If you go show up at headquarters and say, I want to talk to somebody, forget it. Forget it. You're not going to talk to anybody, and they certainly aren't going to cut you any breaks. Here's the good news. This is some good news. First of all, you have investment groups that are downgrading the value of their stock. Okay, they're doing that because they know this is getting ready to blow up. And my advice to people, do not invest into anything having to do with Florida Power and Light or anything having to do with Next Era, because it's getting ready to get upside down once all these stories really pick up momentum. China is cutting ties with the U.S. on many issues following Nancy Pelosi's visit to Taiwan. my God, you know, we did a story on it. We just asked the question, Nancy, what in the hell are you doing in Taiwan? What are you really trying to accomplish? And of course, all of her flying monkey friends, you know, oh, she has the right to go. She can do whatever she wants. We talked about the fact she went over there without a plan. We talked about there's going to be ramifications. So she's palling around in her pink jumpsuit. I don't know what she's accomplishing. But at this point, we're starting to see an absolute connection to what she did. Pick it up from there.
Yeah, absolutely. China has now come out and they said, listen, we are no longer working with the United States on the most important issue of the day, climate change. You know, we had been in negotiations with the United States. We had wanted to reduce emissions. The U.S. was going to do it. And if we cannot get China, the biggest polluter on the planet, to reduce their emissions, to just now walk out of talks because they're mad at Pelosi, this planet is in serious trouble. It's also military agreements we've had with them, trade agreements. All of this is now going down the toilet because Pelosi decided, I want to go to Taiwan during my little vacation break here, and it screws us.
So you've got, they've already began military exercises just right off the coast of Taiwan that they weren't doing. They've already filed missiles above Taiwan. They've suspended diplomatic ties. This is all because meddling grandma makes a visit to Taiwan because she wants to make a statement about how tough she is. And by God, China can't tell me what to do. Really? I mean, and if you want to support that, you better think it through because this is a superpower we're dealing with. This isn't a third world country. This is damn superpower.
Right. You know, the Biden administration said, look, we don't want her to go, but we're not going to tell her not to. The military was like, we don't want her to go. Nobody wanted her to go there.
MSNBC, CNN, Fox News.
They did.
They wanted her to go there. Nancy, brilliant. You know, what a strong woman you are. And now we're seeing the ramifications of it. The discussion seems to miss the fact that we owe China more than $1 trillion. More than $1 trillion is what we owe China. And when they start calling that in, that's the next step they make. We owe them more than maybe Japan, but it's real close. Japan and China. But as I watch this develop, it's not getting any better, it's getting worse. And God forbid we should have brought it up and actually called balls and strikes. How dare you? How dare you go after the Democrats? We're not Democrat. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a Republican. I call balls and strikes, and I'm going to continue doing that.
Well, and if anybody has an issue with that, then please feel free. Send us an email. Let us know what good came out of this trip, because I'd love to hear it.
Better than that, just unsubscribe to us. If a viewer cannot take an intelligent discussion about calling balls and strikes on something as idiotic as this, they need to go listen to HuffPost. You know, where everybody agrees with everything all the time. That's not this site.
When I was a little girl, I was told at the beach if I dug a hole deep enough, we would reach China. So we've always felt a connection there.
The CEO of Pfizer is furious that Congress is about to pass legislation to lower the price of a few prescription drugs. You know, this is the craziest story. They made $22 billion. $22 billion just off the COVID vaccine, and they're complaining that part of this bill, this energy bill, this Inflation Reduction Act, which finally got passed and is going to create some good on climate change. I really do believe that. So they said, well, you're passing on too much of the bill to us. Pick it up from there.
There's 10 drugs. That in this bill, you will be able to negotiate the price of, only, of course, for people on Medicare. Mm. But even the slightest reduction for Pfizer in that profit, even if it's just, you know, $200,000 a year, it's not okay. So the CEO, Albert Bourla, comes out and he says, I want to say it's very disappointing that they are choosing to single out one industry.
Yeah.
No, you've been screwing over American consumers for 2 decades or more at this point. It's time for you to stop that. And I think that's what scares him is that, again, even though it's only 10 drugs and not all of them are Pfizer drugs, he's worried that people are going to see that they have the ability to lower the prices,
that's exactly. There's some infrastructure in place that says, you know, we're going to take a look at the. Well, here's what I looked at. Medicare paid $7.3 billion in 1 year for one blood clot medication. $7.3 billion. So, you know, finally Congress is getting it. Well, we can get some of that money back and we can pay for things that need to be done. We can pay for energy changes and climate change issues that are important to this world. And, the, of course, now the pharmaceutical industry, who, oh, by the way, made $22 billion on just the COVID issue alone, and they're complaining. Even though we know, you've done stories, I've done stories, where their markup on drugs is as high as 2,000%.
Yeah.
2,000% markup on a drug.
And most of that R&D is paid for by us already through tax dollars, the National Institute of Health. The only money they're really spending is on advertising,
yeah.
And they make all of that back within the first 18 months of the drug.
President Biden wants to run against Donald Trump again, but Florida Governor Ron DeSantis is the one he needs to be worried about. I don't know why people are missing this. I don't think they're missing it. DeSantis, you want to hear a long-term prediction? DeSantis versus Newsom out California. Newsom's going to take the East Coast and the West Coast. DeSantis is playing to middle America. He has a real chance to win the presidency. I don't really think that Trump wants to run. I think all along Trump is, if you look at the way they're interacting, he's the guy behind DeSantis. He thinks DeSantis can deliver on a lot of his ideas without being Donald Trump. What's your take?
Well, the reason DeSantis is obviously a scarier opponent than Trump, which is what Democrats are trying to warn Biden, like, hey, start paying attention to this guy. Mm-hmm. DeSantis, even though I disagree, by the way, with all of his, you know, legislation he's pushed, he doesn't have any scandals. You know, bad legislation is one thing, but there are no scandals involving this guy. There are no skeletons in the closet that we know of right now, and he's not stupid.
He is a very boring guy.
Yeah.
He's a very boring guy. He's not Pence boring, but the difference between him and a Pence is he will push back.
Yeah.
I think the guy's smart, he's strategic, he's deliberate. I think he poses the biggest threat to the Democrats. I think in a lineup between him and Newsom, he wins because you've got this angst that everybody has about the whole California scene. You know, it's a problem that Newsom brings with him. I think Newsom would be a good politician. I think he's going to run a good campaign. And I think it's going to be him when it's all over. It's going to be a tough fight. But, you know, what they don't understand, Florida is firmly a red state.
Yep.
And you have Newsom doing these ads in Florida as if it's going to change voters' idea about the difference between Newsom and DeSantis.
And Newsom's doing that right now in Florida. Do you know what DeSantis is about to do?
Tell me.
He's about to go to Arizona, New Mexico, Pennsylvania, and Ohio to campaign and hold rallies for Republicans. So what this is, which is coming up in just one or two weeks now, this is DeSantis's, basically his audition.
Yeah.
So if he can go to these places where you've got some Trump-backed candidates, because everybody is endorsing or rallying for Trump-backed people, if he does well, and he plays well on those stages. Again, these are swing states he's going to.
Yeah.
This is his audition, this is his big chance, and if he proves he can do it, that's a big, big problem for the Democrats.
Well, you heard it here first. DeSantis versus Newsom. DeSantis takes middle America, he takes the West, he takes the South. Newsom picks up the two coasts. It's gonna be a tough race. This guy is, he's a real campaigner. The FBI carried out a raid on Donald Trump's residence at South Florida Golf Course Resort this week. And everyone on both sides of the political aisle have lost their minds about this event. Here are the arguments. You know, they've weaponized the DOJ, probably some truth to that, that it's going to cause such a surge in GOP interest for the midterms that anything the Democrats gain with the abortion issue is now lost because you have so many Republicans, even moderate Republicans, very angry, willing to show up at the polls. So take it from there. I see a boatload of issues here, but we could talk about this a long time. Why don't you take it?
I don't disagree that there are obviously some political ramifications the Democrats are going to suffer from here, but I'm personally glad that this happened. Mm-hmm. And I do think, I want to throw this out there, is I don't think, you know, everybody says this is, oh, it's the National Archives, the documents that he had there. I don't think that is exactly what we're looking at.
Okay.
I think it's more likely this has something to do, because again, we don't even have confirmation about what it's really about.
Right.
I think this is more about the fake elector scheme, where they've already gotten John Eastman's cell phones, they've gotten Rudy Giuliani's materials.
Well, okay, talk that out a little bit, because a lot of the viewers may not know. Yeah. Talk about that issue.
So this is, of course, you know, Trump's attorneys, and as far as we know, Trump himself, were attempting to get by the states, send us alternate electors so Mike Pence can verify them. Mm-hmm. That is the one thing we know the DOJ has been investigating. They've been very aggressive with it in the last couple weeks. Mm-hmm. So for this to suddenly happen now versus the National Archive story, which came out way earlier this year.
Right.
Timing seems to lend more to the fake elector scheme to me.
That's a good point. I think you may be onto something there. The way I see this is the downside to it. We've talked about the church hearings a lot, yep. Okay? This is being shaped up like the same kind of argument that's done in the church hearings. If you think about it, the church hearings really started with the idea that maybe the IRS, it started with a Phoenix program that a guy named Colby was running in Vietnam, where he was assassinating people unnecessarily, and it was an ugly, ugly story. But then the sub-part of it began that the IRS, they had added all these agents, and they were targeting political opponents. It was part of the DOJ process. The DOJ themselves, they were targeting political opponents. They were doing things like, following journalists around. They were doing things like eavesdropping, bugging houses, bugging cars. So it was a really ugly time in history. And I think about this is being turned into that a little bit. This is being turned into, this is going to be another example of weaponizing, you hear that term a lot, weaponizing the Department of Justice. I don't know. But I'll tell you something, if it does go forward, what we're going to see is when the Republicans are going to take, they're going to take over at some point. And when they do, the people that ought to be really careful are people like Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton and Hunter Biden. The people that were behind this raid themselves. It's going to be a parallel to the church hearings.
Well, and we do have some interesting things here, too, because Christopher Wray, the director of the FBI, This guy Trump put up there.
Yeah.
So this is a Trump guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So far right now, we're still trying to learn a little bit more about who the judge was. I think right now it's
Reinhardt.
Was it Reinhardt?
Yeah, a guy named Reinhardt. Okay, he's a magistrate.
Okay, so he's not a political appointee.
No.
At least.
Well,
okay.
They're already starting to attack him. You know, they're tying him up to the fact that of his wrongdoing when he represented the people that were involved with Epstein were raping kids.
Yeah, I did see that, yeah.
So he represented these people, even though he had inside information from a prosecutorial standpoint. He comes out and he starts saying, I'm going to represent these people that are caught up in the Epstein trafficking issues. He represented some people that are accused of trafficking. And so they look at him and they say, that's where they're going to start their fight. First of all, the magistrate shouldn't have even issued the subpoena. It's impossible for us to know. We haven't seen the subpoena. We haven't seen the search warrant. We know they've got into his safe, and it was empty, you know. And we do know this. We do know that, the people who are constitutional lawyers, really good ones, say that they really got ahead of themselves there, that this is the last possible act that the Department of Justice should have taken before they negotiated for these documents.
But if we do not know, obviously, which investigation this is about, this might be the last act. I mean, might be the final, nail in whatever coffin it is they think they have. If it is the fake elector scheme, again, they've already gotten all of his associates, all of the enablers, the lawyers, their cell phones. If they're looking for the final missing piece of the puzzle. And another interesting thing that happened too, though, at the same time, right before this happens, we get the major bombshell from Maggie Haberman, who sends out the photos like
pictures.
This man flushes documents down the toilet.
Well, there's always suspicion that was a setup picture. You've seen that.
Yeah. I mean,
there's always suspicion it doesn't have anything to do with government. It's just private. But so the point is, there's no turning back here. Okay, this has never been done to a past president in the history of the country ever. And so the point being is, like Axelrod said, they better be damn sure that this is a tight case. It's an open and shut case. Because if it's not, we've got a DOJ that's going to be on the ropes. We've got an FBI that's going to be on the ropes for quite a long time. I think that's going to happen anyway. I think you're going to see the Republican base empowered. They're going to turn out in droves.
Well, and Republicans have already told us if we take back the House, guess what? We're doing the Hunter Biden investigation, which the DOJ is already investigating Hunter Biden right now.
Yeah.
So that is happening.
Supposedly.
But they've also said we're going to investigate Fauci. We're going to investigate Pelosi. We're going to investigate everything.
Merrick
so they
Garland.
Can just add another one to the list now.
Yeah. Which I think is going to be disaster for them. I mean, Republicans are going to do the same thing the Democrats did and spend too much time investigating and not time enough legislating.
Well, that's...
And they're going to fall into that. It's like a trap for them.
Well, and I will say, you know, bringing up the fact that this hasn't happened to a past president before, it should have happened to George W. Bush.
Absolutely.
With the whole torture and all of that. You know, we should have seen it back then and set that precedent.
But they didn't because they didn't want that president. That's what happened there, Sharon.
Eric Holder was a coward as well.
Yeah, Eric Holder was a coward. Well, the old, I think it's early to say we've turned into a banana republic, but this is something that you see in South America. One political power is they're in power, that they're then out of power, and the investigations and prosecutions start. That is almost, you know, that is the way that a third world country operates. So I think it's too early to say that right now, although you have people saying banana republic, third world countries. I don't know. I think it's too early yet. We don't know enough facts.
Yeah, and I think once we know what exactly this was related to, again, my money at the moment is on the fake elector scheme.
Yeah,
I just think that makes more sense.
You may be right. Let's hope it's something that they can actually, because if you're going to threaten the king, you better kill the king.
If they fumble this, that is not going to look, I mean, there's nothing that would look worse than that at
That's
this
true.
Point.
Thank you for joining me, Farron.
Thank you.
That's all for this week, but all these segments are going to be available this week, this coming week, right here on this channel. You can follow us on Twitter at America's Lawyer. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this has been America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you stories corporate media won't tell you because their advertisers won't let them, and their political connections don't allow for it. We'll see you next time.